Welcome to this WKTV sports presentation. I am Mike Maul, and we are here once again for the 12th annual Stubby Overmire Card Collection Show and Auction. Coming to you from Wyoming Lee High School, it's the annual fundraiser that Ty Emelander and a whole host of others put on as fundraising for the Lee Athletics. We will be joined later in the day by three of the members from the 1968 Detroit Tigers World Championship team. We'll have a first-timer here. The super utility man, Tommy Mathcick, will be joining us, along with Grand Rapids native Mickey Stanley. And as always, he's never missed one of them. Baseball's last 31-game winner and two-time Cy Young Award winner, Denny McLean, will be joining us. So sit back. We hope you enjoy the program as we interview not only them, but various vendors throughout the day. And we thank you for joining us. Joined by every year at the front table, right here by the autograph table, Tom Brooks. Tom, how you doing today?
Doing good, Mr. Maul, and yourself?
I am doing well, sir. Good to see you, as every year it is here. And every year, I know you always have something special that you bring to this show. What is this year's big deal?
Well, what I picked up at an estate sale is this 1950s uniform, complete with a skirt, shocks, socks, pants. It's got a letter of authenticity of it. They had to remove the emblems back in the day if the guys were keeping it. And this gentleman removed the name as well. But it's a really unique piece. It's something you'd probably see in a man cave or bronze hanging from the wall complete. So that, I guess that's the neat special thing I might have brought for today.
Well, that is definitely a neat, special thing. And I also have to comment on a poster you've got down here. We've been talking about this already, Tom. Why don't you describe this one to us a little bit?
Well, what we have down here is the 1968 championship team, of course, with the Game 7 scorecard. And that's autographed as well as the 68 cards. When Mr. Brock was signing this, he said, if I'd have slid in Game 5, we'd have won the series. And I said, so Lou, does that mean you were out at home? And he said, I didn't say that. And he pushed it towards me and said, next. And, of course, when old mean Bob Gibson signed it, he just, so it was kind of neat getting stuff like that signed and seeing the reaction of the athlete.
Absolutely. So how long ago did you get them to sign that, Tom?
That's been a work in art probably since I was 8 years old,
oh,
you know.
No,
yeah, that particular piece, probably mid-80s.
Okay.
So lots of fun, lots of good times in that.
It's hard to believe that we're coming up on the 50-year anniversary of that World Series. That's your shirt right here says.
Right there, buddy. I tell you, couldn't have been a nicer shirt for this year. So, I'm stoked about that, happy to be around for it, you know, along with a lot of the stars. We got Tommy Mathcick today, maybe Denny, and then Stanley and Denny tomorrow. Boy, what a good Sunday.
Yeah, no kidding. Have three members of the 68 team. That's a good group right there all by itself.
That is a good group, and there's not very many past that, you know. I think there's probably maybe 10 guys after that are still hanging on.
Yeah.
So,
my wife gave me the greatest Christmas present ever. I got a bat from this man last year, and it has, I think, 13 or 14 autographs from that team on it, and that was a special thing. And this poster right here, I'm not saying it's going home with me yet, but it might be before the day is out. Thanks, Tom. We greatly appreciate it, as always.
Always a pleasure to see you guys. Thanks for behind the camera as well, Gary. You know, you guys do a great job. I enjoy the disc when I get it. Thank you.
Thanks, Tom. Appreciate it, as always.
Always, man.
joined by Ken VanderSlik here at his table today. How are you doing so far, Ken?
Awesome. Having a great day so far.
Good.
You bet.
Good. We've got a three Tigers coming out today. Kind of a different story. Sometimes we have one, sometimes we have two, but we got three today. What's your specialty? You got Tiger stuff down here any place for everybody?
This is some Tiger Tiger book here with a whole bunch of them in there for about $12 to $15. And I've got a lot of Tiger team sets there. And I generally sell quite a few of them at the show. And this is a Craig Monroe. Used to be, of course, he's an analyst now. But it's only $10. The reason it's only $10 is because the bat fell off.
Oh, okay.
But, whoops. But I got glue
just
with
like
it.
That.
See? I put glue with it. So you got to have a little sense of humor, too.
That's,
you know?
Right. You got to enjoy yourself doing these
things.
I do.
I sometimes get a little crazy, but, you know, it's the hobby.
Yep.
And, you know, I don't care what people say, as long as they don't slam my Tigers. So I'm a Tiger fan. I bought my first baseball card in 1955. It was one card and one stick of bubble gum for a penny.
Oh.
And the lady in the grocery store in the community we lived in way up north, she said, "You're wasting your money." You know what the 1955 Bowman, that we called them the old television card, what they were worth now if you had a Mickey Mantle?
A little more than that penny.
Yeah. But, you know, I made 75 cents profit. 25 cents went to baseball cards, 25 cents went to church, and 25 cents went to school clothes. That's the way it was in those days.
Yep, exactly. Do you come out to the show every year, Ken?
I'm out to this show every year. This is one of the better shows. The people that run it are friendly, and you know, the atmosphere just seems to be more positive and friendly. You know, people will spend money on things if they want a good price, but they want to be treated with a smile and stuff, you know. If you're a grouch, they'll walk right past you and spend $5 more at the next table.
Yeah. And especially, like you say, the cause that it's for, Wyoming Lee Athletics, and the job that Ty does putting everything on is just tremendous.
You know, when the Cubs were losing all their seasons, everybody was a little bit of a Cub fan. Like we're all a little bit of a Lee fan, you know. And not everybody likes Danny Mccain, but look what he's done for Lee High School.
Oh, absolutely.
You know, I mean, we can tell about all the tragedies and shootings and all that stuff, but these are things that are real. They mean something. These kids stop by coach over here, you know, and they'd love to talk to him. What does that say about the coach when the kids to the school, and there was three different nationalities. It didn't matter what they were.
Yep.
He's a great guy, but he takes time to listen to him and talk to him, you know, and that's kind of what this whole represents.
Absolutely. I do not live in the Lee community, but I'll tell you what, I never hear anything bad about the Lee community. The tight-knitness and just the love that everybody has is just unbelievable.
But, you know, we can all say, well, I got this many dollars in my account or this many whatever, big house. But if you got the love and admiration of young people, you've done the job because they're our future. You know, I had a guy tell me one time that when the kid makes a mistake, you just hug him a little harder. And some of these kids turn out to be great leaders. Yeah, I mean, Lee High School has a reputation for caring, and that's why I started coming here a few years ago, and I wouldn't miss it for the world.
Well said, Ken. We greatly appreciate it, and I know Ty does too, and we thank you for the time today, and all the best.
You bet. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
You bet. Okay? Thank you.
2017 update set, the third series, and there's three judge rookies in there and four Emelander rookies.
Use them bitter like bubble gum. You chase them, watch them run. Converse side, you precious queen bee strutting, moving to your own beat. No.
Now we're joined by a very familiar face in the Wyoming Lee community, Tom DeGennaro. Tom, how you doing today, sir?
Oh, I'm doing fantastic. Having a great time. Thanks.
Absolutely. So, what do you got going on today? Anything special going?
No, just, you know, this is a hobby that my good friend John over here and I have been doing since we were really young kids.
Just a couple years ago then.
Yeah, about 2 years ago we started this hobby, and when we were both in seventh grade. And something that we still share together, you know, after 40 years of being friends or 50 years, whatever it's been. Something that we can still share, and we do this show once a year to support the kids here at Lee and to have some fun too, because we always set up by Ken, and we just have a good time.
Speaking of the kids at Lee, you have a little inside interest there, being the football coach again this year.
Yeah, I'm a football coach, and I've coached track here, and I did 1 year of soccer. I've taught here for 18 years. I'm a little vested in this place.
Just a touch. You guys started off great this year, but then you hit that unbelievably tough OK Silver Conference.
Yeah, there was four playoff teams in that conference, and the teams that didn't make it, like Hopkins, they're traditionally a powerhouse, and Calvin Christian, a very good program too. Just a great, great small school football league. And we're still building. We're gonna get there. We're gonna still have bumps in the roads the next few years, but we're gonna get there. So,
from the point of view, you're seeing it on both sides here as a person within Lee, as a coach, as a teacher. What does an event like this mean to you and your student athletes, Tom?
I think it's just another way to highlight how special Lee is in the Grand Rapids area. The things that we do in this community, I mean, a lot of people look at it's older, and some parts of it's run down and stuff, but the heart and soul of the Lee community is unbelievable. So it just gives us a chance to show us that this is just a real special place. I mean, it really is. We have a new superintendent, and I talked with him earlier in the year, and I said, it's a diamond in the rough. And he said, why isn't it a diamond? And I liked what he said when he said that. I said, you're right. Let's start calling it a diamond.
There you go. Certainly some things to look forward to from that point of view.
Yes, definitely, definitely, yep.
Well, Tom, we appreciate it as always. We wish you nothing but the best, sir, and have a great couple of days today.
I will. I'll have fun, that's for sure.
Thanks, Tom. All right. We are joined by first-timer here to Wyoming Lee from the 1968 Tigers, a super utility man before that term even really came into play, Tom Mathcick. Tom, welcome to Wyoming.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Absolutely.
Beautiful town up here.
Where do you live right now,
I live
Tom?
In Toledo, Ohio now. Grew up in Pennsylvania.
Okay. So this northerly weather here is very familiar to you.
This is nicer weather than back home where I grew up.
There you go. What are you doing these days, Tom?
I'm still with an aerial photography company. Okay. We do about 8 states, do the aerial pictures of homes, farms, businesses.
Yep.
Still going strong.
And how did you get hooked up into this? Through Denny? Is that how this
came
about?
Oh, God, here we go with Denny. Denny called me and said, Tom, I have a place for you to go. And I said, what is it, about a half hour from home? But anyways, Denny set it up, and Ty was really nice, and I called Ty, and I'm here.
Well, we're welcome.
Michigan was my favorite place to Michigan people. I got traded in 70. I went with Boston, Kansas City, Milwaukee, Baltimore. But I'll tell you what, out of all the people that you really love to play at one place was Michigan.
Yep.
The people here.
Yep. Absolutely. And that 68 team, you guys just missed out on the pennant in 67 by a game,
I believe.
Yep, exactly. And the 68 team, you started off, everything just seemed to really gel in spring training, and you just expected to be that, or did that just kind of come about?
Yeah, Freehand took charge of the guys. Bill took charge of the guys and says, hey, we got to really put our butts to work. And we want to go all the way this time. And it just seemed like everything gelled for us. The pitching, the hitting, everything just gelled, the chemistry.
Yeah.
That's how you have to win.
Exactly.
You got to have some chemistry on a club, and you got to get some breaks.
Yep. Now, I find it interesting, as I was doing some background check, you did not even play baseball in high school, though.
No, I played basketball and football. And I played with my dad's team, a semi-pro team. I played with the men when I was 15.
Oh, wow. So how did you get found then from that point of view to head into the baseball career?
I went and played a little Babe Ruth.
Okay.
We went to Stockton, California in the World Series. Had some other tryouts, and I'd come down to – there were some other clubs interested in me, but I signed with the Cardinals.
Yep.
And then Yankees I could have signed with, too.
Okay.
Then my first year, the Tigers drafted me from the Cardinals.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how I wound up in Detroit.
There you go. 68. Hard to believe it's coming up on 50 years this next year.
You got to remind me, don't you?
You were 23-year-old, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, I just turned 74.
Yep, exactly.
Yeah.
You know, that had to be quite the experience, that whole season.
That whole season, I don't know what it was, 40 ball games. We were tied behind seventh inning, came back. If you would have walked in our clubhouse when we were down 3-1 in a World Series, you would have thought we were up 3-1.
Really?
Yeah, the guys, their confidence was just way up.
It and you were going up against pitching. An unbelievable pitcher.
Bob Gibson. He struck out 17. I pinch hit against him the first game. Thank God he didn't strike me out, though. But I think he popped 17 of us that game. He was tough.
Unreal.
I mean, he was a great pitcher.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah,
was.
He was a great pitcher.
Absolutely was.
And it was a thrill. Considering the riots in 67,
yep.
It seems like it brought everybody to the ballpark in 68. And the whole town, everybody, start just rooting for the Tigers. And I think it really helped.
Yep. And you, I admire people. I mean, I admire all Major League Baseball players to begin with. But somebody in your position that you knew you weren't going to be playing every single day. You didn't expect to see your name on the lineup card when you walked in. But you had to be prepared day in and day out for that season.
Yeah, because I didn't know if I eventually would play a little bit of first, second, third, short. I didn't do that. My only regret is when I went to the big leagues, when I was at Toledo, I was 162 pounds. I used a 33-inch bat, 30-ounce. When I went up to the Tigers, Wally Moses, our batting coach, gave me a different bat.
Okay.
He says, we want you to use a 34-inch, 34-ounce and just choke up and try to slap the ball around.
Quite the adjustment.
I think I would have done a lot better if I didn't listen to him.
Yep.
But I didn't want to be on a bus to Toledo the next day again. So I listened to what they wanted me to do.
Been there, didn't
want to
go back. Huh?
Yeah, yeah. I listened to what they wanted me to
there
do.
There you go, exactly.
Yeah, we had a great male, Johnny Sane. I mean, I could tell some stories. You probably don't have a lot of time for it here, though, but Mayo was funny.
Yeah, absolutely, I bet. But you did hit a big home run that season. I've been doing a lot of reading about against Baltimore.
Yeah.
Bottom of the ninth and two-run home run to win a ball game.
Yeah.
That had to be an unbelievable. I've read many stories on it saying that was kind of like a turning point that just kind of propelled
the
Tigers.
They were right on our tail, a
exactly.
game or two away. And it was the ninth inning, and Mo Dabrowski was there. Freehand was on first, two outs, and he threw me a 3-2 slider, and I hit it out.
Yep.
I beat Baltimore that year also in Baltimore with a pinch hit double.
Yep.
I beat him another time in Baltimore,
I bet they didn't
too.
Care to see Tommy Magic now, coming up to home plate
Earl
anymore.
Weaver and I played for Earl for a little bit in the Eastern Elmira.
Okay.
I went there and played for Earl a little bit before he got up to the majors as a manager.
All right.
But everybody did their job. I mean, we had – no matter who we put in, everybody did a great job. It took the whole team to get to the World Series and win it.
Yep.
It wasn't one individual, two individuals. You know, Mickey, three-game winner in a World Series for us.
Absolutely.
I like when he hit the home run. He ran 15 feet by first base. Then Wally Moses told him, Mickey, it's a home run. He runs back and touches first base and then goes around. That was funny. I wish they would have recorded that somewhere.
Oh, that's
that was funny.
I never heard that one before.
Oh, yeah, Mickey ran right by first base. I wish I'd get a copy of that thing.
And you said just before we started the interview that you made a promise to that 68 team. What was that?
I'd be the last one standing.
There you go. I know we've lost a few of them already.
We've lost them with Gates and everybody else. And I think of the card games we used to have with Gates and the bunch of the guys and Northrop, the Fox, and Storman Norman. I mean, Storman was the funniest guy in the club.
Oh, really?
Yeah, well, him and Al were like this. Him and Kaline. Al still misses him to this day, I bet.
Yep.
Yeah, but it's just, you know, time catches up with everybody.
Absolutely. Do you keep in touch with them, Tom?
We have some reunions. Okay. I keep in touch with John Ward. My roommate was Fred Lasher.
Oh, yeah.
He threw from down under.
Yep.
Nobody liked to hit against him. He got Mail's doghouse one day, and I think that was the last he pitched.
Never to be seen again, huh?
Yeah. Well, you know, a lot of people don't know. You know where the – I was telling the guys yesterday. You know where the old English D is on the uniform?
Sure.
Well, Mayo had an inside pocket. He kept a little flask in there. About every third inning, him and Wally would go in the tunnel and take a sip. The one day me and Gage Brown is sitting on a bench and Mayo's over in a corner sleeping. That was his favorite spot, sleeping. So Earl was pitching that day, Wilson, and he went over, and me, Comer, and Gates was on a bench, and he's going to go wake up Mayo. We said, oh, boy, this is going to be good. So he goes over and shakes up Mayo, and Mayo talks, you know, Mayo talk. Well, he woke up, what do you want, John? John said, we got to get Wilson out of there. Who do you want me to bring in? Mayo said, well, bring in Timmerman. He said, I liked him, Mayo, but you sent him to Toledo 4 days ago. We just cracked up on the bench.
Man, I bet.
Another time, where the phone is from the dugout to the bullpen, mm-hmm. We saw Johnny go over there, pick it up. Mayo wanted him to warm somebody up. He did it about five times, and then Mayo yelled at him, John, I told you to get somebody up. John said, I can't, Mayo, the line's busy. We had an open liner. The guys would be on the phone calling their girlfriends or their wife or calling the clubhouse guy to bring some hot dogs down the bullpen. Next day, that line was out of there, man. I said, there'll never be another team like that one. I could stay here for an hour and tell stuff that's happened. That's good stuff. You
absolutely
know what I mean?
So.
I don't think they have the fun today.
Right.
You know?
What do you think of the game today as compared to back then, Tom?
I think your guys are bigger, a little bigger, stronger. They got the weight rooms now, which we never had. Don't play with weights.
Yep.
They got supplements. You know, I won't go into the other thing,
right?
You know, the steroid issue,
yep,
and
absolutely.
That stuff. But they want all pitchers throwing 99. Heck, our guys would turn that around.
Yeah.
Willie, them guys would love to see a 98, 90 mile an hour fastball right there.
Yep.
But I think the hardest pitchers to always hit was guys like we hated to see Louis Tion pitch. He had four pitches, came here, motion. You know,
sure.
A guy that's just throwing hard, fastballs his pitch, and he's not getting a slider over. Yep. Well, you're looking for a fastball. But the game has changed, and now they're talking about hitting under the baseball,
yep.
Hitting a lot of fly balls. And if you strike out three to five times and hit a home run, you're in.
It's okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Where ours were try to make contact and get on base.
Yep. Absolutely.
So that, you know, the game has changed a little bit in that aspect of it. And pitchers going five innings. Making $25 million, guys. I need to tell you what our guys are, Mclean or Lowe, you know what I got.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah. Yeah. I've had that conversation with Denny in past interviews, the amount that he made when he won his 31 games that year. I mean, it's unbelievable.
Well, I think Mickey pitched over 300 innings one year.
In 68, he did 331 innings.
331 innings. You know, I believe that Mickey Lowe should be in the Hall of Fame.
Yep.
He won 220, 219 games. I wish somebody would check his record on games he lost by one run. I bet you it's 55 to 60 games by one run that he lost. Which score 6.4 for Denny, we average it. Mickey, we were at about 3.1.
Yeah.
Mickey would come in the next day and say, I guess I got to pitch a shutout, guys. You scored all the runs for Denny yesterday.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, Tom, it's great to meet you. We welcome here to Wyoming Lee. I know they're starting to line up for autographs out there. So we appreciate you taking the time and making the trip over here. And I know you're always welcome back.
Well, I thank you for your time.
Thanks, Tom. Great to meet you.
Go Tigers.
Go Tigers.
New team.
We're joined now by the organizer of this event. I know he gets a whole lot of help with it, but he is the mainstay, Ty Emelander. Ty, welcome once again. Great to be here.
Thank you, Mike. Thank you, WKTV, for coming out now for 12 years in a row.
Number 12 started up here. You got three Tigers from this 68 team here this year. That's great.
Yeah, if I'd have known Tommy Mathcick was coming a little sooner, we probably would have advertised it as a 68 Tiger mini reunion. You know, it's 50-year anniversary coming up this summer, and it's kind of neat to have, you know, hear the story, especially. I love hearing the 68 Tiger stories.
He went through a couple of them during the interview, and they were very good. He had us rolling in here. I imagine last night, if you had the chance to sit down, you heard some too.
Oh yeah, and I've known Denny long enough to share some back with him, so it was a good time.
Absolutely. So this event, Ty, I know I ask you every year, did you ever dream it would be what it is?
No, I never thought it would get this big. I think what helped was Mike Donovan and me talked about making it. It used to just be an autograph sign in an auction. We made it into a card show. And for the most part, the vendors tell me it's the best event around, or they always say it's just got a different spirit to it than some of these other card shows. So that makes it fun. But yep. I never thought it'd get this big. The year we had Dean Chance here, it was crazy.
Yep.
And it was just, it's been a neat experience. It's been fun.
Now, I know this is your primary fundraiser for your athletics. What do the monies go back towards?
You know, it kind of goes, it kind of goes fourfold. We put some money into our youth baseball, which we do here, and we put money into our field, and then we put money towards our kids going to spring trip, the kids that are helping here, earning some money, kids that set up. And then we also kind of partner with the softball program now because the softball girls have been involved, especially the Groendyke family.
I mean, sure.
The Groendyke, last night's the fastest we ever set this up. And it's because the Groendyke kids were here and their family, and they all knew what to do. And it was like, I didn't hardly have to worry. I had to make a couple minor adjustments this morning, but it was set up to go, and we did it in about an hour.
Wow.
So that was really cool.
Yep, it means absolutely.
I get to sleep.
Yeah. Yeah, and like we say, you mentioned Dean Chance a few years ago. We obviously have had Denny every year. Mickey Stanley is back this year. I believe this is his second trip ever with it.
Yes, it is. He's a Grand Rapids guy.
Yep.
Mickey's offered to come many times, but I don't want to always push it. And
yep.
He this year he said he'd come again, and
yep.
that's going to be a good draw tomorrow. I mean, Mickey, sometimes people forget he won 4 gold gloves.
Yes.
And he was one of the premier center fielders for a long time in MLB.
2 years had perfect fielding percentage as a center fielder, which is unheard of.
Right. Mickey was quite an athlete.
Yep.
Quite an athlete.
Absolutely. Grand Rapids native, like you say. Tommy Mathcick this year. Who are some other ones that you've had join you here, Ty?
Well, we had Jose Canseco last year, which was a fun time. Bob Feller, that was a neat deal. An 89-year-old man got an airplane and come all the way here.
Hmm.
And the footage, he came in on a Thursday. We just did autograph signing.
Okay.
And then we did the show that weekend. But Bob, the footage, somebody in our tech department recorded over it like a day later, so we never got that footage, so I always miss that. But Bob Feller was a great time.
He had
a great memory for an old guy, 89, getting on a plane and coming to Grand Rapids, not knowing where you're going. It was just amazing. It was a really neat draw. We had John Vanderwall here at one time. I'm trying to think of anybody else. We had Rick Kruger, who went here to lead. He did it, and it seemed like there was a couple others, but I can't think of them all right
absolutely.
Now.
Absolutely. Ray Bentley, I believe he was here for
Ray
a year.
Bentley. Ray Bentley come and helped us out.
Absolutely.
On the football side of it.
Yep. As you look around, I mean, I was shocked. I saw on your Facebook notice the other day, Lee High School has a 1 square mile district. That is unbelievable to me.
When I went here, it was amazing. You didn't just know the kids in your class. You knew the kids from... You're a senior, you knew the kids down into probably the middle school, you knew everybody. So, and it's still that way. Everybody knows everyone. If you, if you say, do you know this kid from Lee? Everybody knows him.
Yep.
It's not it's nothing like the school that my kids transferred from, like Hudsonville, where they didn't even know half their classmates, much less the whole school.
Yep, absolutely. And I know we talked a little bit before the show, and we're going to dedicate the show from the point of view, longtime WKTV announcer and friend Ray Pueller just recently lost his wife Shirley.
Yeah, Shirley was my mother's best friend. They graduated the same year here together. And this is one thing I'll always remember my mom said about Shirley. She goes, I've known Shirley my whole life, and I've never heard her say a bad word about another person. And if you think about it, that's an accomplishment. Because, I mean, my goodness, I can't hardly imagine doing that. I'm going to say something bad about Hanson here in a half hour.
I don't think you've had too many bad words for anybody either, Ty. In the amount of time I've known you, I know you have the utmost respect from everybody here in the Wyoming Lee, and I've never heard anything negative about you. So I know it's greatly appreciated. What's the ball team looking like coming up this next spring?
Those guys might give you a negative word once in a while if you catch them at the right time. But we got... We actually got really a pretty good strength pitching wise. Defensively, I don't know. And part of it kind of pans out to if we can get all of our athletes eligible and playing. We got a couple of kids that are on the bubble, and we hope and pray that they can overcome some of their, sometimes it's grades, sometimes it's laziness, sometimes it's social issues. So
sure.
We're really hoping and praying that they can pull it together and enjoy their senior year so they have something to look back on.
Yep, absolutely.
And, you know, and get in the habit of doing things, you know, positive.
Right. And hopefully with a change in management and everything going on in Detroit, we can have something good rolling out of the Tigers as well.
I truly believe that it's going to be a minimum of 3 years.
Yep.
Minimum, no matter who manages that team.
Yep.
You know, Osmus, a lot of people said he couldn't manage a fruit stand, but the team he had at the end of the year was, you know, nobody could really do much with that team. It's going to take a while.
Yep.
It's going to take a while. We need some guys to get healthy again, and you know, we're paying some big money for a long time.
Yes, absolutely. Well, Ty, I know you've got an awful lot of things to do. It's always a busy day, but we greatly appreciate you inviting us in to do this, and we certainly appreciate all your efforts of putting this together year in and year out.
Well, I hope nobody ever underestimates my gratitude for the help, like you guys. Like I mentioned, the Groendyke family. Tammy Schaefer's been here every year cooking the cheese broccoli soup, and people in the concession stands, Lynn Veldhaus and her husband's helping out. My players are here helping out, and you know, the Groendyke girls, my goodness, they know exactly what to do. So yeah. I'm sure I'm going to forget somebody, but it's been a fun ride.
Good.
And we just hope to keep it going and maybe try to find ways to improve it every year.
There you go. Lucky number 13 coming up next year.
Yeah, like once again, my prayers still go out to old Ray Pueller, and you know, he's going to have to make some adjustments in life, but Ray's a tough old Hudsonville guy, and I think he's going to do fine.
Absolutely. Well, Ty, thank you, sir. We greatly appreciate it, and all the best.
Thank you, Mike.
Thank you.
Sunday's 26. Here and the bacon's on.
24.
The eggs are frying and the coffee's warm.
Now we're joined by one of the players from Wyoming, Lee. We've heard him affectionately called this morning Mikey. Yep. So how are you today?
I'm good. I'm happy to be here.
Good. Ty got you working out there doing different things?
Yeah, I'm supporting our wrestling team and baseball team. We got a bake sale going on today and possibly tomorrow for making money for us.
Okay.
So to help us.
Wonderful. So is this your first time at this event, or have you been to it before?
I've been here for almost 7 years now.
Oh, wow.
I've been here since third grade, and it's kind of a big thing for me because I was always the one doing the auction and helping out and carrying the stuff down.
Okay.
So it's kind of a big thing for me.
Yep, absolutely is. So you play baseball.
Yep.
What position?
I'm a pitcher, I'm a catcher, and I'm a shortstop.
Okay, so you get around all of them.
Yep.
Kind of. Tommy Mathcick would appreciate that, a utility from that point of view. And you're in what grade?
You said I'm a 10th grader.
Okay, so you're looking at possibly varsity, if not varsity, JV for sure this year then.
Yeah.
And you played at Pinery Park, I heard?
Yep, I played for 6 years, I think it was.
Okay.
And when I played, I was in and out playing. And then when I got to majors, I was a star player for our team.
Okay, wonderful. From the point of view, like you say, you've been here for 6 or 7 years, so you see this event year in and year out. What does it mean to you from that point of view? What opportunities and things do you see as a result of it?
It helps us make a lot of money for our spring trip. So, like, if some kids can't pay for it, Ty jumps in, gives them some money, and we can always go and work and get our team much better.
Yep.
So it kind of like shows that Ty is a very good coach and wants our team to get better.
Yep, absolutely. I know he cares about not only the sport, but the school and the students themselves.
Yeah.
He always has such high praise to speak of everybody.
He's always around, and like now he's driving buses and doing yard work and stuff. So that kind of helps us because then he could talk to some kids and get them joined in on it.
See him in a different setting than what he normally might. Absolutely so. From the point of view of being a player and just the various things that have gone on, what do you think about being a baseball player right now?
I think it's a good thing for me because it kind of helps with wrestling and watching my weight. And when it comes down to it, I've played since I was little, So I love it. I love the sport.
Okay.
It helps.
You like it better than wrestling, or is wrestling above it?
It's kind of even right now, but wrestling season just started, so okay. Never know.
All right. Good deal. Well, we thank you very much for the time. We look forward to what tomorrow holds here at the show. And best of luck as the season kicks off in the spring.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming.
I don't know if you ever seen it. That's the 68 rings. I got a chip in the Onyx, but
that's
the 68 championship rings we have.
Swore I was never gonna fall, I was never gonna leap, never gonna jump in. I swore I was never gonna risk, I was never gonna hurt that way again.
We're joined now by Mike Donovan, one of the teachers here at Wyoming Lee. Is that correct, Mike?
That's correct.
All right. What do you teach?
I teach 8th grade U.S. history.
Oh, cool. That's a challenge.
Yeah, it's fun. I enjoy it.
That's great to hear. How many years have you been doing it?
23.
Oh, good for you. All here at Lee?
Yeah, pretty much.
That's wonderful. Did you go to Lee?
I did not. My wife is a Lee grad. Okay. She's graduated in 97.
Okay. Yeah. Good deal. An event like this, you see it from the inside out, if you will, and I know we talked a little bit, you were over by the tables for where the auction stuff is going to be. What does this mean to Lee High School?
Well, it means everything. You know, we use the auction and the autograph signing and the show to promote events like Lee Rebel Baseball, and then we use the funding to send our students to camp in Kentucky. And there's no other way that they could really do it without an event like this.
Yep, absolutely.
And so it really means a lot to them and to us to see the players come in and and be willing to donate their time to support our students.
Yep. 23 years as a teacher, you have seen an awful lot of changes in that time, both not only school, but student-wise. Mm-hmm. What is a biggest challenge for you these days, would you say?
Right now, I think the biggest challenge is just keeping up with the new state standards curriculum. Okay. You know, just staying on top of it. You know, just making sure that everything that you do is engaging. And the thing I try to do as a teacher is I say, am I being the kind of teacher I want my son to have?
Sure.
Am I making things engaging? Are they fun? Are they relevant? Are they interesting? You know, and with history, it's fairly easy to do,
yep.
You know, so you can try to come up with planning that's interesting for the students.
Yep. And at that age level, though, eighth grade, that's kind of the in-between. They're in the junior high, middle school, whatever mm-hmm. you want to call it, looking forward to getting to the high school, knowing, okay, but the eyes are getting kind of big to that freshman year next year type of a deal. Mm-hmm. So the impact that you can have on them has got to be tremendous.
It is, you know, and I try to think of myself as just one step in the process. You know, I'm just 1/13th of the process.
Yep.
You know, and I try to, you know, make it interesting, like I said, but then also I want them to know that they can always come back to me and talk to me about different things.
Yep.
I seem to reconnect with them in the high school. The nice part about being here at Lee High School is that I get to see the students from sometimes the sixth grade when I get to know them initially all the way through 12th grade.
Okay.
You know, so you have a significant impact here.
Absolutely.
You know?
So. Yeah. Yeah. Like I say, from that point of view, the challenges of a student today have to just be unbearable at times.
You know, there's a lot of things that they bring in socially also, you know, from the outside world that sometimes can get in the way of education,
sure.
Relationships, anything like that.
Yep.
I've seen a lot over the years.
Yep, absolutely.
And you just are just their advocate. And
right.
No matter what, you give them advice that you'd want a teacher to give your own kids.
Yep.
To these students too.
Absolutely. So well, I'm sure that the students, like you say, a lot of them will come back to you afterwards. That's got to be very, very rewarding when you have a student that you had and turn around and come back 1, 2, 3 and maybe even 4 or 5 years later mm-hmm. and have a conversation with you.
Right. I want to see students that I have originally in the eighth grade come back to me like 10 years later.
Sure.
And I want them to be genuinely excited about what they're doing with their life, and I want to hear about that.
Yep.
And it's a win for me.
Yep.
You couldn't give me any greater gift than that. I have a student I work with now. I run a food truck out in the parking lots at Lee High School. Mm-hmm. And I was off for medical leave last year, and he rose to the occasion and filled in my role completely. And he did it just as well as if it were me.
Yep.
You know, that's what I like to see with our kids.
And something like that says a lot about two people. It says something a lot about that young man, but it also says a lot about you with the impact that you have had and the training that you have gotten them into to be able to do that.
Right. Well, thank you very much. Absolutely. I appreciate you saying that.
Absolutely. So. Well, Mike, we appreciate the time as always. We wish you and Lee High School nothing but the best, sir. Well,
thank you, Mike. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
All right.
Have a great day.
Yeah, you too.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. How many guys have ever done that for you?
No kidding.
Nobody knows.
Yeah, how many guys have ever done
something? None. Now there's one.
Denny.
Sadly. Joined by longtime Wyoming Lee supporter, Denny Groendyke. Denny, how you doing today, sir?
Good. How are you, Mike?
I am doing well. Thank you. Once again, 12th annual. It's an event that just keeps getting bigger and bigger and bigger.
Yeah. We 12 years, that's a long time to do the same thing over and over. But we keep having success, so why change it? If it's not broke, don't fix it.
There you go. We got three of the 68 Tigers in this year, so that's a little bit bigger than usual, and it's a full two-day event this year. I know you tried 2 days last year, and the second day just didn't make it, but tomorrow we've got Mickey Stanley and Denny McLean both coming in, so it should be a big day tomorrow.
Right. Autographs and an auction on Saturday draws a big crowd, and if you just do a card show on Sunday, and draw as big a crowd, so you get autographs on Saturday and Sunday, and it should bring in the people.
Absolutely. So you've been involved in all 12 of them?
I have, yep.
What is that like to put something like this together? I know Ty, every year when I talk to Ty, he gives you the highest kudos, and you and your entire family.
Well, he puts most of the stuff together. We're just behind the scenes. I have a large family, so when we come to get something done, we get it done.
Yep. That's the Wyoming Lee way of doing things, though, isn't it?
Yeah. We're a pretty close family here in the district. So.
Absolutely. Have you lived in Wyoming Lee District your whole life, Denny?
I actually, I came to the district in second grade, and I moved away probably for 3 or 4 years after high school, and then came back.
Okay.
So, out of my 57 years, I think I've been here probably 50.
Okay. And how many kids went up through the district?
7.
All right.
Well, I still have 3 in school.
Okay.
The other 4 have all graduated from Lee.
All right. Any grandkids hanging out there that are
I do.
Going to be coming up through the same district?
Well, I had a granddaughter that went to school here, but they moved a little bit further north. Okay. So she doesn't anymore. I don't know if any of the other ones will, but I have currently have 4 grandchildren and 2 on the way.
All right. So. Well, that's great. As you look at some of the athletes that have come in here, I mean, people ask me, I talk about this at my work, and, you know, Wyoming Lee, where is Wyoming Lee, and how do they get those people to come into their type of a thing? I mean, it's just, it's mind-boggling to some people as to bring them in. Did you ever think you would be seeing some of the people that you have been able to see over these 12 years come in here?
To sign autographs?
Yeah.
Well, Denny McLean's a huge part of that.
Yes.
I know when Ty contacted him 12 years ago, he said, heck yeah, I'm in, let's do it. And he's been here every year for us.
Yep.
And he, you know, his connections and Jane Overmire, that people like that help make it happen.
Absolutely. We just had the opportunity to talk to Jane, and I know it's not her favorite thing to do, but she always brings a great autographs, brings great memorabilia to the auction and does a great interview with us.
Yeah, and she, I think she shows up every year.
Yeah.
I mean, not for a long time always, but she's usually here every year for something, maybe the night before dinner or the card show.
But. Yep. The Lee community, what does that mean to you?
Well, like I said, we're a small district. We're a quarter or a mile square district. So, when I went to school here, I knew everybody.
Sure.
I knew every single kid in the school and a lot of the parents. So, there's good and bad to everything.
But yep.
Being it's a small community, you know all the teachers, you know all the kids. It's good.
Yep.
It's more like family than it is a school district.
Absolutely. Get out to the sporting events often to see them?
Well, I'm pretty busy. Not as much as I used to, but I still, I got kids that still play in the school, so I make what I can. My business has really taken off in the last few years.
Well,
so
that's good.
It occupies more of my time now.
Yep. But, not many businesses can say that these days.
I'm in construction, and the economy is doing well in that area. So,
good.
Yep.
Well, as always, we appreciate the effort and the time that you and your entire family put into it. Ty said he had nothing to do with it this year. He said, I came in basically an hour, and we were ready to go this morning because of all the work you guys did. So,
we did. We actually had the fastest setup last night we've had in 12 years.
That's great.
You do it long enough, everybody knows what they got to do, and they get it done.
There you go. Well, that's good to hear, and it's wonderful to see you, as always, and the efforts that are put forth. I know it's greatly appreciated.
You also. I appreciate all you guys do for us.
Thanks, Denny. Have a great day.
You too.
You said you'd come back, and so I waited.
We are joined now by Stubby Overmire's daughter, Jane. Jane, welcome once again. We greatly appreciate you taking the time.
Thank you. It's always nice to be here.
I know it's not your favorite thing to do, but we greatly appreciate it.
It's fine.
Every year you bring some special thing for the auction. What did you have over there this year?
I brought a clock, and it's got the Detroit Tiger logo on it, and it's has a neon. If you plug it in, it has this bright neon orange light around it. It's cool.
Yep, absolutely. So, you have it made around here? Or where?
No, I found it at the same place. I bought a cornhole game a couple years ago, and it was in that same shop.
Okay.
And I met the man that makes the cornhole games, because I wanted to get another one of those, and he's so busy, couldn't get one. But he had a great idea. He said, for next year's auction, why don't we come up with a design, and he'll do a custom one.
Uh-oh.
He said we can put Stubby Overmire on it, or we can put Lee High School or something. So that's my project for next year.
There you go, absolutely. That would be wonderful.
I think that would be sort of fun.
10 years ago, you would have said cornhole, and everybody would have said a what?
And it's so popular now.
It is.
I went online just to look for cornhole games. They had probably, it's almost like every sports team has one. They have them for Halloween and for Christmas. I was like, oh my gosh, it's very popular.
Yep, you go out to any football tailgater right now, you see them all over the place at the colleges and everything else.
Well, it's sort of like horseshoes. And my father loved playing horseshoes.
Okay.
Always, there was always a horseshoe pit someplace, either at my Uncle John's or at the lake. So it's almost that same, the same sort of game, but you can move it around.
Sure.
And I think that's the fun thing. You can do it at a tailgate. You could do it, at a picnic. So next year, we'll have a custom made one, hopefully.
Something to look forward to for the 13th annual Stubby Overmire Card Show.
I know it. Gosh, I can't believe it's been that many years.
Yeah, and speaking of, we were just talking before we started the interview, your dad would have been 98 this year and has been gone for 40 years.
He died young, 98 years old,
Yeah, died very young, 58?
57. He was 57.
Yep.
And, you know, he's missed a lot of baseball. I mean, he's missed a lot of the things, if he hasn't been watching. And like I said, last season for Detroit, you know, maybe that was,
maybe,
you know,
just some for the best being missed.
Yeah, something for the best being missed. That's right. So, yeah, he would have been that old.
What do you think he would think of an event like this in his honor?
Oh, my gosh. I think he would be, I think he'd be very proud about it. He loved Lee High School. And my mother went here, too. And a lot of my relatives or friends of my relatives, they've all gone to Lee High School. And I think he'd be real pleased. And I think he would be very pleased to see the sports complex. I think he'd be very proud of the fact that someone thought enough about him to name that the field after him.
Yep.
So, yeah, I think he'd be real excited about this.
It's an amazing community when you stop and look at it, isn't it?
It really is, and they do so much for the kids, and to keep this going so many years. I mean, obviously, my dad wasn't a Mickey Mantle or a Denny McLean, or, you know, but to keep this going in this community, I think is wonderful. I think it says a lot about the community.
Yep.
And where their, you know, their interests lie, and it's trying to better the atmosphere for the kids.
Right.
And I think that's important.
Yeah, absolutely. Like you say, the community, but the Ty Emelanders and the Groendyke family and you and just so many others that still have the true care and concern. That's what young kids need these days.
They do. They really do. And they need to have a place that they feel secure in.
Right.
And I think that's here and in this community. And with all the things that are going on, if the kids know they have a safe place, in a place that they can participate, be successful,
right,
you're going to keep them off the streets. Yep. You're going to keep them focused on staying out of trouble.
Yep.
And absolutely, that's what we have to do.
Yep, without a doubt. Well, Jane, as always, it's a pleasure to sit down and talk with
thanks.
You. It's always fun to see you and hear stories, and we greatly appreciate it.
Yeah, thanks so much, and keep up the good work, guys.
Thank you very much. Great day.
Yeah, thanks.
That's competition. I don't know if he'll come out for dinner to sign a jersey for you. He just met him. He didn't invite you over for dinner.
Nothing will top that birthday, though. Nothing. Suddenly, Denny McLean comes walking in, signing an autograph that my lovely wife put together for me. That will never be topped, Gary. You did very good. You're an endless flowing river of love. Once again, we are joined by two-time Cy Young Award winner, baseball's last 31-game winner, Denny McLean. Denny, good to see you again,
good
my friend.
Good to see you, too.
Welcome back to Wyoming Lee. I know it's getting to be a second home for you. You've been here so many times.
Lots of good times, a lot of good people. We've always enjoyed ourselves, and the way the thing has come along here with the baseball park and some of the other things we've been able to do, it's just been great, just terrific.
Absolutely. It's always good to see you and have you back here. I know Ty appreciates it. You've been a busy man, though. You've been doing a lot of card shows lately?
No, not really.
No?
My wife is very ill, so it kind of takes me off the road. The only things I can really take care of are the things that are very close to us. You know, we have a small business and what have you. And
sure.
That's the only thing that I could really have a lot of time for. But the shows we're doing right now are, we probably canceled more shows this year because of her illness than we've done. And I normally do 150 to 200 shows a year. So, and that, of course, a lot of that is baseball parks that I do during the summer. But we're hoping to see some improvement in her status. And if that happens, of course, we'll be out there a lot more, but we're going to do as much as we can.
Yeah, I keep trying to keep up with you and her on Facebook, and I keep seeing the posts and everything, and keep in mind that prayers and thoughts are with you both, for sure.
You know, you got to work, you know. I mean, you can't, if you can't work, God, you got all the medical to pay for. You got, sure, you got good insurance. I think most of us do, but there's still above that line,
right.
You know, it's always cash, cash, and more cash.
Yep.
It's kind of right now with the argument that's going on about health care in this country, and you know, they want to whack the people who can't afford it.
Right.
It just doesn't make sense to me at all. So
yep.
Hopefully something good will happen.
Yep, absolutely so. Well, our cameraman there, Gary Vandervelde, sent me a post from when you came in. I know you didn't make many relief appearances, but he sent me one from 1965, I believe it was. You came in against Boston and struck
right.
out like the first seven batters that you faced.
I think so, yes.
That's you didn't make many relief appearances, but that had to be a memorable one.
No, I think, as a matter of fact, that ball game was probably my moment. It was, they had, excuse me, we had started the year off. I hadn't pitched very well. And, you know, you hope you reach your groove to some degree sooner or later. And while I threw well in spring training that year, wasn't quite there. And they brought me in that night. In relief, we were down a couple of runs early. I think Dave Wickersham started the ball game. And I come in, struck out the first seven. I think we struck out 14 or so over the next few innings. And then that got everybody's attention, and I got tossed into the rotation, and then I was in the rotation forever. But, you know, the moment you get your opportunity, you better be ready.
Yep.
And I don't know how you define ready, but you only hope that you're ready as well as you can be when they say, you're pitching next.
Right.
So, you know, because it's tough to get to the major leagues to begin with. Very, very difficult. You got to climb over everybody in your own organization. Then once you get there, if you don't work five times or 10 times as hard to stay there, you won't stay there very long.
Yep. Yeah, that's like yesterday. We had Tom Mathcick sitting in the chair that you're in right now, and I had a great interview with him. And I told him, I said, from that point of view, I truly admire people in his position, being a utility man, not knowing when your name is going to be on that starting lineup, when you show up at the ballpark or not, but to play four, five, six positions such as he did, there's something to
be
said.
Yes and no, but if you're a utility player, you have to be able to play four, five, six
yep.
different positions. You have to be ready all the time. You have to be the cheerleader on the bench all the time. You got to be at the park early. You got to be the last guy to leave. You got to really be in their face in order to get an opportunity.
Sure.
And if they perceive, the ball club themselves, if they perceive that you do not have what you'd call a nine-inning player, you know, that they title you in
yep.
some form, one way or the other. And most of the time, they do it too early in your career. And unfortunately, I think that's what happened to Tommy, because I think Tommy got some bad advice because we thought he was a pretty good hitter in the minor leagues.
Yep.
And I know a couple of guys changed his way that they wanted him to hit, and it caused him some problems, but one thing about Tommy, whenever you called on him, he was ready.
Yep, absolutely. You had several of them on that. Gates Brown that year, he came in many times as pinch hitter.
Yeah, but he was hardly a utility player.
No, I mean, not a utility, you know, but I mean as a pinch hitter.
I mean,
type
he was a player.
Deal.
I mean, Gates was a real, real hitter.
Yep.
Probably the best pinch hitter possibly in the history of the game.
Yep.
He knew how to, the difference between Gates Brown and everybody else is Gates knew how to hit. Gates knew what to do when the situation called for it. And he was just one of the more impressive guys when it came to grabbing the bat and knowing what you needed to do.
Yep, absolutely. From the point of view of that team, I mean, you had characters all over it. I mean, we were hearing some of the stories yesterday from Mathcick, and we were just rolling listening to some of these things. How much do you stay in contact with those guys, Denny?
Well, there aren't many of us left.
No, exactly.
You know, it's been 50 years now, and we got a bunch of guys, not a bunch, but we got a number of guys that are ill.
Yep.
And anybody out there who wants to say some extra prayers, say some extra prayers for Bill Freehan. Bill could use him right now. And there's several other guys out there that are suffering right now. And it's just amazing to me. You know, 20 years ago, life was still pretty good.
Yep.
And all of a sudden, you hit that mountain. And once you hit that mountain, things don't get so good so quickly anymore.
Sure.
But we've got, as far as the starting nine, as I would call it, Bill obviously can't attend any functions. Cash is gone.
Yep.
McAuliffe is gone. Mathcick is still with us. Stanley's still with us. Don Ward is still with us, although I think he's ill. Willie Horton is recovered from, I think, 80 operations on his back. He went from 5'10" to 4'6", I think. say Stanley, I talked about. Jimmy Northup is gone.
Yeah.
I just was with L. I was at K-Line yesterday in Chicago for a few hours.
Okay.
He looks good. He still looks good. He's 82, 83.
Hmm.
So but then the rest of the guys who are not the starting nine, most people can't even name them, much less figure out where they are. I know
yep.
Daryl Patterson is hurting. And some of the other guys, I think most of them are gone.
Yeah.
It's just, I mean, we had a reunion number of years, 40th reunion a number of years ago, 10 years ago in New York, and there were three or four times as many Cardinals that showed up
really?
As showed up with our guys.
Wow.
I think we had three or four of us show up for the dinner because everybody was sick.
Hmm.
So it's, you know, I mean, we've been ill for a long time.
Yeah. And how are you doing?
I'm okay. I just got some screwed up knees and like everybody else, but had one replaced and now it's going on the fritz.
Oh.
And then I don't suspect I'm going to let the guy do the left one.
Might go to a different one or not do it at all.
I'd rather go to Helen Keller. You know, got a better chance.
Well, we mentioned Justin Verlander. He got his World Series ring with Houston.
Good.
Yeah, good for him.
Good for him.
Got married to Miss
Kate. He didn't do it when he was here.
Yeah, exactly.
That's when he came here, if he was what he thinks he is, he should have done it here.
Yep.
We had some good, better than average good ball clubs.
Absolutely.
And, of course, we know he didn't pitch very well in the postseason with us. But he just... You know, I don't know what it is. I one time had a conversation with him in a ballpark, and I said, don't you dare put your fastball away, because there for a while, and I think what hurt him is, he started getting hit once he got into big leagues, 2-3 years later, started getting hit pretty good. And what happened was, all of a sudden, he started leaning on a breaking ball. If you're going to lean on a breaking ball at 25, 26, 27 years old, you're in trouble already. Yep. And somebody told him to do it. I mean, I don't think he would have done it on his own. And that's what kind of screwed him up.
Yep.
Because he was very inconsistent after that. And of course, as we know, in the last 4 or 5 years in Detroit, you know, except for this little run he'd have in July and August,
right,
which meant nothing at that point in time, you know, he didn't pitch very well. But he certainly showed everybody what he's capable of doing with Houston.
Yep.
He rose to the occasion, as they say. And he had it's amazing that he had his best stuff 3 or 4 times in a row.
Yes.
Because we all have, you know, if you're successful up there, you have consistency is all you really want. If you all of a sudden you have your great stuff one time, you'll have great stuff maybe 6 or 7 times a year. And then you'll have above average stuff probably 50% of the time.
Sure.
And then the rest of it, you got to battle like hell. But, that's where I think our guys have lost it. And I think one of the problems is they only have to pitch 100 pitches, more or less, 5 or 6 innings. And I think what they do is they try to throw as hard as they can for 5 or 6 innings. Well, what? You're drained everything by the time you get that's not the way you pitch.
Right.
If you pitch, you pitch. You just don't go out there and throw 100 pitches and say, oh boy, I'm done now, I can go in the clubhouse. That's just not the way the game is played. And as we saw a lot of other crazy things in this World Series, I mean, guys coming in and pitching one inning. I mean, it was nuts.
Yep.
And what I'm afraid of is, when I was in New York a couple of weeks ago, I heard a rumor in the commissioner's office that, you know, one day it'll probably get to no umpires, which would be a serious mistake. And then secondly, who knows, we may never, ever, ever, we may have a defensive team and an offensive team, much like football. I mean, so they're talking about a lot of crazy things, but the umpire thing, I think people go to the ballpark for a number of reasons. Be entertained, watch their teams, cheer and rah, rah, rah. But also you go to see the Billy Martin kick dust and dirt and throw and spit at people. And also, and George Brett knocking the bat and screaming and hollering and running at the umpire. I think the umpires are a part of the game. They are an entertainment factor. You can't argue with them anymore.
Yep.
You say anything bad, you're either fined or you're sent out of the ball game.
Yep.
So I don't know where it's going to stop. I know they're trying to make the game quicker. You cannot make the game quicker if you use 4 pitchers on each team every night. They haven't figured it out. And all they got to do, and be honest with you, this is the truth. It can't work at one time in the history of the game and not work now. Raise the mound where it belongs to 16 inches. Bring it back where it belongs. That'll speed the game along.
Yep.
You can't believe how much quicker the game will be. Guys will pitch a lot deeper into the game. that additional leverage that you get from the mound being rose to 16 inches is unbelievable. And I can prove it. In 1968, I struck out 280 guys. In 1969, pitched just about the same number of innings, in fact, maybe more, 69, and I struck out 100 less because they reduced the mound 6 inches. I lost 6 inches of leverage. Still won a Cy Young and everything,
right.
But it wasn't the same guy pitching. And if I didn't have, if God hadn't given me good control, I probably wouldn't have had that year in 69. But the bottom line was, the mound, it made all the difference. By the way, out of the top 25 or 26 pitchers in 1968 at the end of the season, 19 or 20 of us were gone by 1974.
Iron Trolls? Really?
Every one of us.
You think it's because of the mound?
Of course. What else? What other explanation could there be?
Yep.
I was gone.
Yep.
I mean, I had a bad arm during that period of time, but that 6 inches of a lever allowed me to play a little bit and get as much out as I could. And even with a bad arm, struck out 280 in 68. But the bottom line is, once you took away the next 6 inches, boy, it was a task. It really was a task.
Yep. Yeah, I was looking at numbers again the other day, as I always do before we get together. And I'm still absolutely astounded. In 68, you had 41 starts and threw 336 innings. I mean, just a touch under 9 innings average per ball game. As you said, today, that's absolutely unheard of, even to have 3 complete games in the course of a season.
Well, that's how dramatically the game has changed.
Yep.
I mean, it's not the players. Excuse me. It's not the players that want to pitch less or play less. If you do not, I don't care if you're a cameraman, you're a host of a show, you are the grease guy down at the lube place. If you do your job every day a lot, you get very good at it. Why should a pitcher throw any less, and how does he get any better?
Sure.
A basketball player will go out and shoot 50, 100, 200 free throws a day. Football player, a quarterback, will throw 50, 60, 100 passes a day. A hockey player will hit 100, 200 slap shots a day. These are all practice.
Yep.
Why is it a pitcher throws 5 minutes, 7 minutes, 6 minutes, and only does it like once between starts?
Mm-hmm.
You cannot... Unless you're born with a lot of talent, you cannot rise to possibly where you could have gone. And that's the problem. If you do not allow these guys to pitch deeper and deeper, they'll never learn a trade. And that's half the problem, because now all they look at are guys who can throw the ball hard.
Mm-hmm.
And they don't throw the ball any harder today than they did in the 60s and 70s. The
right.
game hasn't changed that dramatically. And I would suggest to you that when the mound was 16 inches versus where it is today, the guys in the 60s, 50s, 60s, and 70s probably threw the ball harder
mm-hmm.
because they had all that leverage.
Right.
But nobody wants to talk about that.
Yep.
Nobody wants to protect the pitchers anymore. And as long as that pitcher is mound gets less and less, it's going to cause more pitchers to get hurt. We're going to have more arm problems and various other things. Line drives off the head, off the leg. You're seeing more and more of that. And the reason why is because the pitcher is getting closer and closer to being on the same plane as
sure.
the hitter. And that's dangerous.
Yep. And not only that, you look at the strike zone as to what some of these pitchers face. I mean, back in your day, you could come up high and inside just to make them not be comfortable and kind of control the ball game.
Well,
nowadays,
sure.
you do it. And
but they can still do it. I mean, but
you do
you
it.
Can't,
but
you can't... They can't be as aggressive as we were, and I don't understand that.
Right.
Because hitters now, more or less, are protected on both sides of the plate.
Yep.
Because baseball wants home runs and touchdowns. Baseball no longer wants 1-0 games, mm-hmm. 2-1 ball games. So, despite the fact that that's going to be their 2.5-hour game, right? So, if they don't do something, and I don't think, I'm not going to set off a siren here, but I don't think if they don't do anything about the long games that the game will suffer. I really don't. I mean, this is our game,
mm-hmm.
and the game is going to continue. As long as we have stars that come through the systems all the time, we're still going to draw the way we draw. But I just hate the idea that these pitchers aren't getting the protection they're supposed to have. They're paying them so much money, yet not taking care of them. When it comes to being in the game. It's one thing to have them run 10 miles a day to get in shape and lift weights, which is ridiculous for a pitcher, and some of the other things, but the bottom line is, if you don't let them pitch, they'll never improve.
Yep.
speaking of umpires, back in your day, who was an umpire that you just really did not want to see behind home plate when you took the mound? Was there anybody special?
I don't think so.
No?
You got to get along with the umpires. You can't give them a hard time. They got long memories. they will absolutely chop your liver out if they do remember. They will remember. And you know, every time I'd walk up to the plate to these guys, hey, how's your wife? How's the kids? If you get a chance, you got a day off. Come out to the house. They would never come out to the house. But you did everything you could to get them to smile and laugh a little bit. And
yep.
Because we were able to, when we played, and with all the things that were going on in the game, we had one great advantage. If you were a good pitcher, and you were consistently a good pitcher, later on in a ball game, if you had a 3-4-5 run lead, you got the benefit of the doubt on close pitches.
Okay.
I still think they do that with some pitchers in the major leagues today, but not as many as they used to. So that also sped the game up a little bit. But I would hope that they could figure out that you got to raise the mound before you can improve the fast quickness of the ball game. Because mm-hmm. Some of these games, I mean, I did not see one World Series game end except the Houston. I think I saw one in Houston end, but the rest of them, I fell asleep.
Yeah, it was very late by the time they got going. How long would games take back when you pitched?
2:15, 2:20.
Okay.
I averaged about 112 pitches, 115 pitches a game.
Going even as far into the game
sure,
as what you did?
Sure, nine innings.
Wow.
You know, strikes, that's what it's all about.
Yep.
If you can throw strikes, the game's going to automatically be quicker.
Sure.
But these guys today, they pitch a little bit differently. There's an old rule that if you're even or behind a hitter, you can throw a hitter a changeup. You never throw him a changeup if you are behind the hitter, okay? Because it gives the hitter an extra nanosecond to catch up with the changeup. You're seeing more and more of that going against the book. And that's another thing. The rules don't apply anymore. So when you got a hitter 2-0 now, we used to throw a changeup, maybe an off-speed curveball, slide, whatever it might be. Today, if they got a guy 0-2, they throw him a changeup. It's just absolutely 180 degrees backwards.
Yep.
And that's what, I don't know where it's coming from. No one's ever written that that's the way to pitch. Not one book will you ever read that says, well, when you get a guy 0-2, throw him a changeup.
Yep.
It just is, it's ridiculous because if you do throw a strike, somebody's going to hit it somewhere.
Sure.
Why? I've always said this. When you get a guy 0-2, 1-2, why give a sucker a chance? Just throw a good, hard fastball inside, maybe barely outside, but you got to throw something hard that he cannot reestablish himself as a hitter in that nanosecond.
Sure, absolutely. Back in your day, you had to bat. Do you approve of pitchers batting, or do you like the DH?
Yeah, it doesn't make any difference to
no?
me. I just, I like the bat, but I certainly wasn't an asset. And I would rather have somebody up there hitting for me than me being, you know, almost an automatic out. Most of the pitchers are.
Sure.
So it's nothing that I led the league, I think, 2 or 3 years in the most sacrificed bunts. So I got real good at that, but because I knew I couldn't hit.
Yep.
So there's certain things that you can do for yourself. And back when we played, if you did not do some things well in the fifth and sixth inning, when your bat came along and you were one or two runs down, they took you out. Well, if you could bunt a little bit, put the ball in play a little bit, they wouldn't take you out. You'd mm-hmm. get one more shot at winning a ball game. So all of that enters into it, you know, as a part of the game.
Absolutely does. Well, the Tigers this last year, it got rough. A good way of putting it, my friend. It got rough. Mr. Osmond.
Once they got rid of Mayburn, that told you right away they weren't going for anything. Mayburn was one of the best hitter players on the team. I mean, that kid could play.
Yep.
And the very first guy, and then you say you're getting rid of him because you're paying him $2 million more a year. What about Verlander and Cabrera and some of these other guys you're paying 12, 14? How about the pitcher, Sanchez?
Yeah.
Excuse me. What a mortal sin that was.
Yep.
So they were going to worry about nobody bought the story that the $2 million made a difference because this kid could play. It's just a shame. And I think that's spelled a little bit of doom early, And then the spring training goings on and some of the other things that are going on in the ball club that a lot of people don't know about. You know, when the somebody once said, and I'm not necessarily talking about Detroit, maybe read between the lines, but, you know, when the asylum is run by the lunatics, the lunatics will enjoy a good time, but sure. They can't win much.
Yep, absolutely. Ron Gardenhire, good hire, you think?
Well, I think appropriate for the time. He can't hurt the club. Ron is a fundamentals guy. I think what he will bring back to the club is how to play the game, bunts, hit and runs, running and hitting, hit and cutoff men, pitchers covering first base well. Those types of things make all the difference. And I think you'll see a much stronger defensive team than what we've seen here the last couple of years. Yeah, I mean, I love our shortstop. I think he's got great ability. I think he can be one of the great superstars in the game if he quits playing on the man. What I mean by that is he jumps up to make the play, does this. Everything is in the air, in the air, in the air. Well, you're not going to win as many ball games. You're not going to win as many plays either by your feet leaving the ground.
Sure.
There isn't a sport that we play anywhere in the country that if you leave the ground, it's beneficial. Think about that.
Very true.
Not a sport, except for basketball, would be the only one you could think of. But the bottom line is, leaving the ground in a baseball game or a football game, I mean, it leaves you open to getting hurt, too.
Absolutely.
But I think this ball club is, first of all, they're very bad. No one should expect miracles, although in our division, anything can happen. I mean, we got a crazy division. But I suspect that Gardenhire will be here for two or three years. I think they're trying to groom somebody else there. In fact, I think the guy, my own personal opinion is, the guy they're trying to groom there is the guy that's going to manage here next year.
Lance Parrish.
Lance Parrish. That's what I believe. To be honest with you, I don't know why they waited, because I think he can manage now. Most catchers can do a pretty good job. What happened with Osmus, I don't know. But Osmus, the last year or two he was here, I don't know what it was a couple of years earlier, but he seemed intimidated by the players. And when that craziness went on that he was getting fired 2 years ago,
yep.
And then Cabrera went up to the front office and said, no, don't fire him, he's a good man, he's this and this and this. And then they rehired him, that means the lunatics are running the asylum. And that can't be. You've got to have, first of all, we have a discipline problem with that ball club. And I think they've gotten rid of some of those guys. But I think you'll see more go. And I'm talking about discipline on the field. I'm not talking about off the field. But if they concentrate on playing the game, you'll see some improvement. I mean, probably won't win it, but you're going to see some streaks that they'll come about this year. They got to find some pitching. We have no pitching.
No.
I mean, I know we had a kid win the Rookie of the Year, and who knows what he's going to be in 3-4 years. I mean, the test is now the next five.
Right.
So, and he's got pretty good stuff. I was impressed with him the first year he pitched, and he looked great because he impressed me with his control. That's what got me. If you don't have control, it's a very tough game to play.
Yep, absolutely. So, do you still get out to watch games at all, Denny, or not?
I probably see, with my wife being sick, I got out probably 3 or 4 times this past year.
Okay.
Normally, I get out and see a dozen games
okay.
from time to time, but I don't stay for 9 innings. You know, the traffic out down there is.
Yeah.
And I'm not complaining about the traffic, but by the time, with these knees, by the time I get to the car, it's tomorrow. You know, it's.
Coming up on the 50-year anniversary, as hard as that is to believe.
Hard to believe, isn't it?
It is. It really is.
Who the hell thought I'd live to be here? That's what's unbelievable.
Well, Tom Mathcick said yesterday he made a promise to you guys as a team that he was going to be the last one standing from that team.
No, he's not. I am. Listen, my dad died at 36 of a heart attack, although he smoked 3-4 packs of cigarettes a day. He had just come home from the military. And my great-grandfather died at 38, and then the great-great-grandfather died around 40, 41, and I'm 73, and I got them all. I mean, no matter what happens, I'm way ahead the rest of them, and if I could just get Sharon on that right track, life would be really good.
Absolutely.
But,
so.
Except for my knees, I think I'm okay, but, you know, illness today is a quick thing. All of a sudden, it's there. It's biting you in the butt.
Sure.
So you just never know. And yeah. And diet plays such a big part of it, and your lifestyle plays a part of it, and the cigarette smoking stuff and all this, you know, I mean, God, if we haven't learned by now what cigarettes can do to you, we'll never learn.
No, absolutely not. Is there anything special planned for the 50-year anniversary? Have you
there's
heard?
There's a whole bunch of things. They haven't sent us an itinerary yet, but I understand there's a zillion things that they're planning. They got the first thing they're doing is they're having the 68 Club down for a special weekend down to Lakeland, late January. And I don't know how many guys will be there, but I don't even think we're going to be on the field. I think it's a couple of dinners and get-togethers and that, and with sponsors and what have you.
Sure.
So it sounds like a pretty good time. It's a five-day event. Because every year with the fantasy camp, they've come down and played two fantasy camps back to back. Well, this apparently is knocking out one fantasy camp. They still have one fantasy camp in place. It's just like Tommy Mathcick said to me the other day. He says, I haven't gone in a while. And I said, why? He says, hell, I'm old. He said, you know, every time you go down there, you get hurt. And he says, guys come back with stretched this muscle, that muscle, mm-hmm. Torn ligaments, and he says, God, we come home and we can't walk for 3 weeks. So, it's like he says, they don't pay us that much to come home and not be able to walk. So it's, once you reach a certain number, you're in trouble.
Yep.
I mean, it just takes a little bit. It's like this morning coming out of the hotel, I missed a step. You know, God, I thought I was going to stop down the block someplace.
Oof.
It just, just craziness, not watching what you were doing.
Sure, absolutely. Well, I tried to get our old buddy Ray Pueller to come out and do this interview with you, much as I love doing them, but I know you
feel
too.
Feel terrible for him.
Yep, absolutely.
I talked to him last night for a few minutes. We tried to get him here today. He's just, we all understand what he's going through.
Yep.
And all we can do is say some prayers for him and wish him the best. And hopefully next time we come back to town, take him out to lunch or something.
Yep, absolutely.
And if you're out there listening, you're buying. That's all there is to it. You've never bought a damn thing in my life.
Well, you had yourself, Tom Mathcick, and Mickey Stanley back this year. Almost like a mini reunion there.
Yep. We tried to get a couple more guys, but this is a big weekend in the collection business, in the memorabilia business. And I had appeared at a show in Chicago the last 2 days, Friday and Saturday. And it's a monster over there. I mean, they've got, I think 100 guys are signing autographs in 3 days.
Oh, my word.
Yeah, it's a monster. I was with Al most of the day yesterday. So it's really a great time. A lot of guys I haven't seen in a while. Including some football players. I used to gamble once in a while a long time ago, and I ran into the Kellen Winslow.
Oh, my.
The ball game, I don't know how many out there will remember, but there was a very famous game, San Diego versus Miami. And the game, I thought it went 3 or 4 overtimes. Yeah. It actually only went 1 extended overtime because there were so many injuries. And it was 96 or 97.
Yeah,
that
I remember
Saturday.
The game.
Remember the game?
I do.
And Kellen Winslow was the hero of the day. I mean, he was unbelievable. And it's the first time I'd seen him since that game.
Okay.
And I went up to him and I said, I got to tell you something. He says, what? I said, I gambled a little bit when you played football. And I said, I got to thank you very much because you took me out of a hole. I said, somebody talked me into playing a parlay one weekend, which I never played. And I said, I won more than chump change. And I said, God bless you and your family and everybody else. Then I find out he's now teaching at Madonna in Detroit.
Oh, no kidding.
Yeah, so I got his card
so
yesterday.
So in your neighborhood,
gonna
basically.
Go see him. Yeah, going to go see him next week.
Absolutely. Well, Denny, as always, it is truly a pleasure.
Thank you.
I have to tell a story here real quick. My wife, this jersey that I have on, and Gary's got
looks
the back
good on
picture.
You.
Thank you. It really does from
really
the backside.
Good.
Here, we'll turn around real quick and so you can see it.
Stand up. So
and I'll just keep
it.
Right on talking. I had a birthday in January.
Now you can sit down.
And my wife bought this thing. And then he was going to ship it out to me, but instead, he was down at a show in Coldwater, I do believe.
Oh, my God, that was you?
Okay, I'm memorable.
If I'd have known that, I wouldn't have done it. Was that you?
It was me.
You got a great wife.
I do. She's sitting right here, and I would say that even if she wasn't here.
You're his wife? you are a saint. Unbelievable. God almighty.
But anyway, it was going to get sent out, and we didn't make the sending in time, and Denny came up out of cold water after a show and
You're
met
right.
us at the restaurant
You're
out in Granville,
right.
and I was just floored, and he was nice enough to sign a couple of baseballs and definitely signed the shirt and brought sure. it to me, and I will never forget it, Denny. I can't thank you enough.
I never tried to put one and one together, but it just came together. I can't believe it.
And it came to three, right?
I thought you looked so much younger then. Didn't he?
Well, it was almost a year ago.
Well, I guess you could get as old as you look now. Unbelievable. I can't get over that. Everything goes full circle. Everything goes full circle. Because I couldn't get over it. Most of the shirts here, I know who's got them.
Sure.
And when I saw the shirt on you walking around outside, I said, who the hell is that guy? I said, where did he get that shirt from? Then I thought Ty gave it to you, you know. But then knowing Ty, he wouldn't give anything away. So, yeah, that was, oh, that's too funny. God, you're a saint. You're absolutely a saint.
Denny, as always, it's a pleasure, my
pleasure.
Friend.
Thank you very
Blessings
much.
Blessings to you and Sharon. All
Keep
the best.
Keep wearing that shirt.
Now by a couple of very familiar faces here that just love doing this. I'll let them introduce themselves and we'll go from there.
Erika Leon.
Are you sure the last name?
Mm-hmm. Yes. Amanda Emelander.
We're asking because last year it was different when she interviewed you last year, but Amanda Emelander, a very familiar name around here, been to all of these things. It never changes though, does it?
Nope. Not really.
You got Denny McLean back again. I know that's always been a longtime favorite of not only your families, but everybody here. Yeah. And Sharon is not doing too good. Certainly thoughts and prayers there. But what are you doing now? We're going to do that. I know you've got one little one that's running around here. How old is she now?
She's two. She'll be three in June. So she's at a fun age right now where she's actually starting to talk and you can understand her and... She wants to kind of be independent, so it's a fun age.
There you go. I bet Grandpa's loving it. I see he's been carrying her around a whole lot this weekend.
Yeah, I'm really surprised with my dad. He's very loving towards her and just, yeah.
And on this side, you said...
differently right now as a grandpa than as a dad. Yep.
Because
I remember he was hard on me, like, when with everything. Not obviously not as a dad, but, like, when it came down to softball, like, he'd be hard on me and stuff. And with Bella, like, he'll tell her no, but it's just, like, different.
It's you know? Okay, though, right?
Yeah, she can get away with a lot more.
It's not that hard lock no. It's just no.
Yeah.
She's so cute. No.
Exactly. It's okay. And how about on your side? You have how many?
One, and one on the way, but 3.5-year-old.
All right.
Madeline, and... Yeah, she's just running around, talking, getting into things. It's fun because now they play together and we have play dates. And Bella's now at the age where she can play with Maddie, and so it's a lot of fun.
There you go. You two are, how far away from each other do you live?
10-15 minutes.
So together a lot of the time then?
Yeah.
So and then just the close-knit of the Wyoming League community carries down to the next generation from that point.
Yep, exactly.
Yeah. We've been friends since we were probably 6 or 7, close, playing ball together and stuff.
We were probably friends before we even, like, realized, like, oh, yeah, she's my friend. Like,
yeah, I don't remember a time that Amanda wasn't around, so.
There you go. Well, it's two very good families here from that point of view. I know that, and I know they're well-respected, and the Wyoming Lee community means an awful lot to them. But I know they also mean an awful lot to the Wyoming League community. And not just from this event, but from so many other things. Yeah. And would you trade the place that you live for anything in the world?
No, no. I, like I said, it's just always, I don't know how to explain it. It's just so close-knit that you can go up and have a conversation with anybody. And you might not know them personally, but it's they'll sit there and talk to you. Sure. Whereas if you went to a big school, it's like you don't know half your class. Yep. And I've said that before too, but that's the thing that I'm probably going to say the rest of my life. Yep. That I knew or could talk to every single person that I went to high school with. Yep.
And you graduated in what year?
2014.
Okay. And you?
2013. And there's a new superintendent this year, and he was in here yesterday and met us and shook our hand. And that's, I mean, Rockford schools and things like that, they can't say that yep. they graduated 4 years ago but met the new superintendent. It's just not something you hear.
Exactly.
So.
In other words, it's much more than just a face and much more than just a number. Mm-hmm. Well, ladies, we thank you. It's always a pleasure to see you, and hopefully it wasn't too painful.
Not at all.
Thank you.
Search my soul. Make me brand new. Break me down.
Say hello to those other guys.
Oh, I will. Yeah.
Thank you. Oh, I'm sorry.
You have a good day. We have a
special survey office event. 50-year anniversary of Parks and Men here. We appreciate your time coming here. Coming all the way from Brighton to help us at Lee Rebel Lee High School.
Thank you, guys.
Very nice. He's also here with a Lee Rebel Hall of Famer, Dan Manley, who played baseball with Nick Stubby. Dan was a player for him.
Danny was a better player than I was.
Say it again. I tell
Danny. Danny Manley was a better player than I was. Show was Danny. Thank you for coming.
We're joined now by the third member of the 1968 Tigers here this weekend, center fielder slash shortstop Mickey Stanley. Mickey, welcome to Wyoming Lee once again.
Thank you.
We appreciate you taking the time and coming back. You were here a few years ago, and I know you were very well received, and it's greatly appreciated.
Bunch of nice people around here.
Absolutely,
and
it
today
is.
Today I got to meet some real nice guys that I played baseball with.
Really?
Danny Mailing.
Okay.
And Bob Katzma.
Okay.
Who went to Lee High School.
I'll be darned.
Yep.
That's wonderful.
Yep.
Yeah, Grand Rapids native. You
correct.
Played with Sullivan's Furniture.
Sullivan's Furniture.
Yep. Was Bob the one that signed you originally?
Bob is the scout that signed
okay.
me.
Okay.
Absolutely.
And you guys went to the national tournament. Was it the first year you were with them? Or?
I really don't know if it was the first or second year I played for Sullivan's. We went to Wichita, Kansas.
Yep.
And I got to bat off Satchel Paige.
Oh, no kidding. Yeah.
He was 60 years old. And
wow.
I think I hit a high chopper and beat it out or something.
Oh, that is a wonderful
one
story.
One for one.
Hey, perfect. Not many people can say that against him.
Correct.
And then 68 Tigers, obviously center fielder. I mean, I was looking at some of the numbers. Two different years, perfect fielding percentage in center field. That is unbelievable. I mean, that is just amazing.
It is amazing, but I didn't know that was true. I knew of 1 year. I didn't know there was two.
Yeah, according to what I was reading, there was anyway.
Could be.
I think
68 really,
and 70, if I'm not
really
mistaken.
I don't really pay attention to the
not a stats.
Stats
person.
Somebody asked, what years did you win the gold gloves? I says, I don't know.
Yeah, and I think
I really
were,
don't.
I think there
I
were
remember.
Four of those, if I remember.
Correct.
Wonderful. That is correct. Great. That had to be quite a difference maker, though, when you were called to Mayo and saying, we're moving you to short for a little while.
That was very nerve-wracking.
I bet.
We were in Washington or Baltimore, and we had five games to go in the regular season. He called me to his room during the day and said, you're going to be our shortstop in the World Series. And I was just dumbfounded.
Yeah.
I says, he says, I know you can do it. And I says, yeah, but what about our teammates? What if it doesn't work out? Boom. He says, don't worry. He says, you can do it. So that was it.
Yep.
It was not enjoyable for me.
I bet.
No, I didn't have a lot of fun.
And if I remember right, the very first batter, Lou Brock, gave you a ground ball to start the series off, didn't he?
A very nice, sharp ground ball, but a nice, clean, true hop. And I made a good throw over to Norm Cash.
There you go.
I remember when I caught that ball, like it was yesterday, I said, whatever you do, don't lob it and throw it in the stands.
Yep.
Or something. So I humped up and threw the ball as hard as I can.
Yep.
We came in from that inning, and Norm let me know. He says, you don't need to throw it that hard.
You're not coming from center field to home plate anymore, huh? What are you doing now, Mickey?
Just killing time till I die.
No.
No. I'm doing a lot of stuff with grandkids.
Okay.
And my kids.
Okay.
I like to work with wood, so I'm always building a
yep.
something.
Sure. Living in Brighton, do I
live
remember?
In Brighton.
Okay.
I live in Brighton.
Yep. Yep. Grand Rapids native, like I say, grew up in the area. That had to be an honorable pleasure to be able to wear the English D, being a Michigan native like that.
That's all I dreamt about when I was a little kid.
Yep.
I used to hold the bat on 28th Street. We lived there out there and listened to the radio. I pretend I was Harvey Keene and Al Kaline and Johnny Groth and Bill Tuttle. And to wear that uniform was a dream come true.
I bet
but
so.
I think that's what kids have to do.
Sure.
They have to want it so bad that they envision it.
Yep.
And I envisioned it, and it happened.
There you go. Absolutely. Yep. And also one of the things that I found very interesting as I was doing a little bit of research, you are one of only 15 Tigers in the history that played your entire career in a Tiger uniform. Mm-hmm. There's a lot to be said for that.
Yeah, I didn't know that. Well, that's because nobody else wanted me. Actually, after I got released, Earl Weaver from Baltimore called me and asked me if I wanted to, what it would cost them to get me to come over. And I,
yep.
My kids were in high school, and I threw a big high number out, and he said, no thanks.
Yep.
So that was it.
Yeah, well, like you say, that's quite an honor. Yep. I mean, not many players on any organization can say that.
Yeah.
But from that point of view, but absolutely. Well, Mickey, we greatly appreciate the time. I know you've got a line out there for autographs, and you've had a line going on for a couple of hours.
It's been good.
Good. It's always good to see you.
Thank you.
Good to talk to you.
Thank
we've
you.
Had you here a couple of times, and I wouldn't be surprised if we get to see you again.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Take care.
Appreciate it.
Oh, you know?
Yeah, design them.
God. Hey, I remember that.
Thank you for watching, and we hope you enjoyed the program here as we conclude the 12th annual Stubby Overmire Card Collector Show at Wyoming Lee. A big thank you to the many vendors and fans who came out over the 2 days, and of course to the Tigers, Tommy Mathcick, Mickey Stanley, and Denny McLean. It wouldn't be the same without you, and also a big gratitude goes out to Doug Hansen and Gary Vandevelde, our cameraman and producer for this show. Great job as always. I am Mike Maul, and it is our honor to dedicate this program to Shirley Pueller, wife of 60 years, who recently passed away, to longtime WKTV supporter and the community friend to so many in this neighborhood, Ray Pueller. Ray and family, our thoughts and prayers are with you.
You are the line I follow.
Guys, come on down. We got lots of deals here for you. As a matter of fact, everything at Kenny's table is 75% off.
How you doing?
You look like a member of the 68 team, for God's sake.
Jesus.
Yeah, they saw the camera and ran.
Back to you. Oh, I thought she was talking to me.
The sky. Thought of it makes me smile.
Oh, excuse me, I'm sorry.
Yeah,
got it?
Oops, sorry.
No, you're fine.
Kick you in the leg.
All right.
That is my wife, by the way. We'll go there right now, so you know.
I was a little worried about that. I thought, uh-oh.
You're better off camera.
I couldn't figure out who it was. I'm thinking, what are you doing?
I am Mike Maul, and it is our honor to see if I can do it straight. It's more than
getting shaky there, so I'm glad she stopped.
I think we'll do that again. Take two.